the Lord, consider yourself blessed. Blessed. Are you happy today? Are you happy today? Won't you stand up on your feet? We want to come together, give praise unto the Lord. We are happy. We're happy to be in the house of the Lord, and we want to let him know that. You should be doing it all week anyway, but just in case you missed out, here's an opportunity for you to make up for that, okay? So we're going to stand up, we're going to praise the Lord, and we're going to give him all the honor, glory, and praise. Amen? Amen. Happy.
I don't know, but everything he's done in my life has been so right. How many of you give God a hand clap of praise today? Because he's a good God, as Deborah said, and he is worthy to be praised. Come on, clap your hands. You make me whole.
You make me whole.
You take the pain away.
Take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
Come on, join us.
You make me happy. You make me whole. You take the pain away.
Come on, you make me happy.
You make me happy. You make me whole.
Everything about you is right.
It covers all my wrong.
Your life.
Your life saved my life.
Come on, everything about you, Lord, is so right.
Everything about you is right. It covers all my wrong. Your life saved my life.
With you.
With you is where I belong.
Oh, we belong to you, Lord, and we're glad to be in the house of the Lord today.
Make me happy. You make me whole. You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
You make me happy.
You make me happy.
You make me whole.
You make me whole.
You take the pain away.
You take the pain away. I'm so in love with you.
Everything about you.
Everything about you.
Forgive of our sins and we repent to the Lord. Do you know he forgives? He is faithful to us, Lord. So we're thanking you right now, Lord, just to be in the house today. Lord, we praise your name as we remember your sacrifice 2,000 years ago. Lord, so many years ago, Lord, because everything about you is right, Lord.
Yeah.
Amen.
Everything about you is right.
Yes.
Amen. Our scripture reading for this morning. Hallelujah. It's going to come from John 15, verses 1 through 5. Let us all read together.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing.
Amen.
Amen.
May God add a blessing to the hearers, the doers of his holy word. Amen. Well, guys, it's a time that we can all join in together again. Come to the altar, lay your burdens down, and leave them there. Won't you come?
All to Jesus I surrender. Why don't you leave it at the cross today? Surrender everything to him. You know, there are areas of our life that we like to hold on to because we think that we can take care of it. But you know, all of our problems are God-sized problems, no matter how little, no matter how big. And God is concerned about everything that concerns us. And we need to surrender our all. And when we truly surrender all and give it to God, then he can move. He's not going to overstep your will. He needs you to get out of the way so he can fix it for you. Amen? So let's learn how to surrender everything that we have unto the Lord. And he will work it out always for his glory and our good. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Let's try that again. All to Jesus I surrender. Everything to him.
God is so good, and I figured that if he can use me, he must have a sense of humor. I'm telling you, just like Deborah said, the fact that we got up this morning and we're here, we are blessed. Grace has been imparted upon us, each and every one. And so I was thinking this morning as God was just blessing my soul, and it sounds like about 200 people in the bathroom, and it's just me and God. just listening to the music and just worshiping him, I was thinking about how much he loves us. And Psalm 139 came to mind. It says, "Oh Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit or stand, but far away you know my every thought. You, Lord, chart the path ahead of us, and you tell us where to stop and to rest. Everywhere I am, you are." I thank God for that. I thank God through the tough times. I thank God through the happy times. I thank God when I'm grieving. I thank God when I can't just, I don't know what to say and can't articulate what's going on in my heart. But I know that it's unbalancing God just my own, because he understands the language anyhow. So I just thank God today that we are more than conquerors. And as we go through this worship service today, let's just think about that, meditate on the fact that God is with us. And because he is with us, we are more than conquerors in him. Let's go to the throne. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment and this hour, God. We thank you that you are with us, God. We thank you, God, that we are blessed, God. Deanna said, "God, thank you for allowing us to be a part of your plan. I got so excited. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of your divine plan, because it didn't have to be so. People didn't wake up this morning. People couldn't start their way. They did not have a place to worship. They did not have someone to hug or some place to go to say, I love you, I care about you. How are you doing today? But you blessed us to be here, right now, in this time and in this moment. So God, thank you. We thank you, God. When we saw you, as Isaiah said, high and lifted up, and the train of your glory filled the temple. God, that means that no matter what my circumstance is, you are. I thank you that you are divine. I thank you that you are the vessel. I thank you that we can say hallelujah. I thank you, God, for your grace. I thank you, God, when we're looking at an upside down world, and yes, we are right now, right here. I thank you that the remnant is still here praying for the nation. I thank you, Lord. Thank you for the pastor who day in and day out, woo, he's on this path. He is on this path. He's a purpose maximizer in you, because he loves you so much and he humbles himself. I thank you for Deanna as she leads the choir, and there are so many moving parts that she's involved in. I thank you for Ella and Reverend Tim and Deborah as they are just blessing the children day in and day out. I thank you for the deacons, where sometimes if you want a place just to come and sit, the presence of the Lord is there. Nothing has to be said. But we know that there's a place of safety and of comfort because you are there. I thank you for the trustees. I thank you for the ushers that are the gatekeepers, God. I thank you for them. They're smiling faces, and they're always looking to take care of us. Ooh, I thank you for that. So many moving parts right here, right now, standing on the floors right here where scripture is laid. Thank you for the musicians. Thank you, God, for everybody that is here. I just want to be thankful. Let's take a moment and give God some praise and some glory, just to be thankful for who we are, where we've come from. Just thank him and praise him right now. He's a healer. He's a provider. We thank you, Lord, for being our father and our mother, our doctor, our lawyer. We thank you, God, for giving us peace of mind. We thank you for that unspeakable joy, God. We thank you because you loved us so much that you gave your life for us. We thank you, Lord, and we bless your name right now. We praise your name right now. We magnify your name right now. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Holy are you, Lord. Don't miss this moment to praise him right now. We don't deserve it. We don't deserve it. And yet, he allowed it anyhow. Thank you, Lord, and we bless your name. Bless the service today. Bless the voices that will raise up your name. Bless the prayers that will raise up your name. Bless the thoughts in the hearts of many that are here today standing in your name. And Lord, if there's anyone that is lost today, anyone that's struggling today, sensitize our hearts so that we can go to those people, so that they can know that they can come to a safe place asking, what must I do to be saved? Lord, we thank you for that. Ooh, we thank you for the Sunday school instruction every day. Ooh, we thank you for the teachers, God. Just thank you for everything. We're just so grateful to be in your presence.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's just do it. I surrender all.
I surrender all.
Thank you, Jesus. Take it away, Lord.
I surrender all.
All to thee, our precious Savior. Blessed Lord. Hallelujah.
Blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen. At the cross. All right, we can all join in. At the cross where I first saw the light. Jesus did it all for us at the cross. Can you help us sing it?
Burn and up my heart, rolled away.
Tell somebody that you love them.
Greet your neighbor to your left and to your right.
God loves you and we do too.
Right, in the book of Psalm 34, verse 4. I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Good morning, Trinity. God is good and he's worthy. Aren't you glad? Amen. Happy September to everyone. We have quite a few announcements. If you have your bulletin, please follow along. We'll talk about the September events and then some of the other announcements as well. All righty, so on September 11th, we will have, that's next Sunday, a Sunday school celebration, also new members orientation, and the encouragement ministry will meet, and those would be immediately following service. We have our monthly Women's Fellowship, which is on Saturday, September 17th at 10 a.m. Please join us, women, and we will study the word of the Lord. Amen. Amen.
And then Sunday, we have our Sunday, September 18th, we have our adult discipleship class. And then on Sunday, September 25th, we have our teen discipleship class, as well as our nutrition ministry. And there might be more information on that, but I'm going to be real honest with you all. I forgot to check the email yesterday. So we will have some additional announcements about that next Sunday. I apologize. Amen? Okay. All righty. Our Compassion Center is open after service today from 1 to 2. We have Children's Church for ages 2 through middle school immediately following the choir selections. And as always, if you'd like to help out, you can see the McCloins. Amen? All right, good news is back. So get that information to Deanna by the end of service today or by Saturday at noon. We want to continue to keep our children encouraged and uplifted throughout the school year. Amen? All righty. If you'd like a copy of the worship service, please see any media team member at the podium over there. And also, just to remind everyone, we are on WYLL 1160 AM every Sunday evening at 7 AM. Excuse me, 70. How can you have evening at AM? You can't do that, okay? So that would be Sunday evening at 7 PM. Amen? And then Monday afternoon at 1 PM on the Total Living Network. Amen? All righty. And also, I have one other thing there. Anyone that helped out with the picnic that's here, if you could please stand. Anyone. If you served, if you cleaned up, if you set up, if you grilled, anything, if you brought some food, anything that you did to help out with the picnic, please stand up. Amen, 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 amen. Amen, amen, amen. I just wanted to give a special thanks from the bottom of my heart and Miss Betty's heart as well to everyone that helped out. Special thanks goes out to the grillers. You were out there in the sun keeping the food moving. Thank you very much. And to all the cleanup crew, thank you, thank you, thank you. And Miss Betty said, yes, did you guys see us? Weren't we stylish? Thank you, Miss Gloria, for giving us our TBCC emblems on our apron. We were trying to be real stylish and official. So, but thank you all. We could never do all that's done for the picnic without the help of the entire congregation and everyone that just gives of their time and of their energy just effortlessly, tirelessly. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Amen? All righty. We got you for next year. I made note. I got it down. All right. We know who brought what. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. All righty. So at this time, we would like to welcome all of our first-time visitors and returning friends. So if you are visiting with us for the first time, if you could please stand, we'd love to give you a warm Trinity welcome. Any visitors? Everybody's at home? Oh, yeah. Our ushers will be handing you a visitor's card. If you can fill that out and just drop it in the offering plate when it passes, that would be great. Thank you so much. We know you have a choice of places to worship, and we are so glad you worshiped with us. Amen? All righty. So next week, we may have a little change in our announcements. So somebody will do them. We don't know who. But we'll get that taken care of. And I promise you, if it's me, I will look at the emails and get all the announcements read. Okay? Amen? Miss Barnes, who normally does it, you know, she's just busy. She got that daughter getting married and everything. So she got a little bit to do. Amen? All right. So y'all keep her prayed up. Amen? All righty. So our thought for the week. I was reading something, and I hope I pronounced his name correctly. Charles Spurgeon. He said, you have never truly found Jesus if you do not tell others about him. I was like, amen, I like that. We are so happy to be in the Lord's house here at Trinity Baptist Community Church. Our bishop is the Reverend Dr. Michael J. Love. Trinity is a teaching ministry of God's holy word. We touch, we share, we love and care, and we thank God always for this opportunity to praise and to worship him. If you are looking for a church home, when Bishop Love opens the doors of the church, please feel free to give your hearts to Christ and your hands in fellowship to Trinity. Amen? All right, y'all have a blessed week, family. All right.
So good to be in the Lord's house on this beautiful holiday weekend, Sunday morning. And I think you're running, we got a couple of marathons going out next Sunday morning. Is it? Yeah, Miss Claire, you got 13 in. First Lady's got 13 coming in. I drag on in here after. We'll be praying for you as our running ministry gets out and blesses through the running, through the ministries of in different areas, whether it's blessing through the water for those in Africa or whatever the cause might be. We've got a number of people that are blessing through that gift of running, and we thank God for you. It's a lot of great things on the calendar. I want to add my voice, if I can, very quickly to the thank yous for all the great things that happened on last Sunday. We just had a tremendous time of fellowship. And especially with our sister, our neighbor church next door with Calvary, as we came together and just blanketed both campuses and had a tremendous time. Thank you all so much for putting it together. They've been burning up my phone and catching me walking by, just thanking us for all that was taking place. Everybody was so blessed at the time that we shared together. Amen. Wasn't it a great Sunday? It's a great joint fellowship in the picnic on last Sunday. And we've got some great things on the calendar for this month, as has been shared with you. We want to make sure you mark your calendars down and come and be prepared to share in some of the great activities for September. We'll continue to share more each and every week as we move towards that. I don't want to take up much time on this first Sunday. I know that as Deacon Norman starts heading this way on this Communion Sunday, let me just ask the question, has God blessed anybody? Has God done anything special for you this week? Worthy of any praise? Come on, yeah, give the Lord some praise in the house. We're going to worship God with our giving on this beautiful day. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Good morning, church. Normally, I come up here and I read a passage out of the Bible when I'm blessing the offering. But this morning, and I don't know why it came to my head, I don't know why a lot of things come to my head. I was thinking about the sermon that Reverend Paula gave a little over a month ago regarding the prodigal son. So I figured, and that came to me to talk about that, and I figured I didn't need to read that because that's one of the most understandable and popular passages in the Bible. And I'm sure there's some of you that can quote it verbatim, so I didn't need to read that. But I was thinking about how many of us have left our father. And this father being, this was a parable, not a story. He was talking about the people's lives 2,000 years ago, and he's talking about our lives today. We've left the father, a number of us, and went out and did our partying, and a lot of us had fallen. And I don't think that you ate with the pigs, but you're not gonna talk about it and tell people about what happened to you. But most of us have taken that walk back to the Father, and we've been blessed so much. You know, we've had our own fatted calves. So I think this is a time that we're going to give back a little of the blessings that our Father has given to us as we've come. And if the ushers will come forward, let us pray. Precious Father, we give you all the praise, honor, and glory. We love you, Lord. We thank you for the blessings you've given to us. We thank you for blessing us with our pastor who teaches us the word each and every Sunday. We thank you for our church here, Lord, where we can come and fellowship with our fellow members and get strengthened up in the word of the Lord. We thank you, Lord, for our families and everything that you've done for us and all the blessings you've given to us. And bless this offering as we give back just a minuscule part of the blessings that you've given to us. In Jesus Christ, our Savior's name, we pray. Amen.
You know, guys, God is so good, and I'm excited about when we all get to heaven, what a time we're going to have. You know, just like we're going to have that, we're going to reminisce about how when we party down here, how we're going to party up there when we all get to heaven. So we're going to We're going to sing What a Time. We're going to have it. We want you to stand up and just join in with us, you know. Clap your hands, stomp your feet, you know. Do what you need to do. Energy song. Got a good beat. Come on now. Y'all know about that beat.
What a time.
So now I owe you me.
honor be unto your precious name. Turn with me, if you will, in your Bibles to the Matthew chapter 20. This holiday weekend, we want to take a fresh look at a very familiar episode in the life and times of Jesus, focusing our attention on chapter 20, verses 20 through 28. We're going to drill into this a little bit, but drill into a passage or two of this a little bit. With a key focus on verse 26 for our reading together. Matthew chapter 20, verses 20 through 28. Verse 26 is our key verse. If you have found that, located that in your Bibles, would you just say amen? We're all together. If you don't mind standing with me, we're going to read this from the King James translation on the screen together to get our hearts and minds focused in one in the same direction. Let's read together. It says, "But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister." Let's read that again. "But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister," your diakonos, as you take your seats. I just want to spend a little time with you on this passage as I'm looking from the theme, two keys to kingdom greatness. Two keys to kingdom greatness. This is one of those rich episodes, and when you read it, you'll enjoy the encounter that's taking place. And it's recorded in Mark, Matthew, and Luke, I believe. And it starts out in verse 20. I have to read it for you, but it gives you some indication as Jesus has now focused his attention during this time frame in the Bible. I mean, his eyes are clearly focused on what's about to take place, the core purpose for his coming. He's going to Jerusalem, and there he is about to fulfill his earthly mission of laying his life down voluntarily for your sins and for mine. There he's about to face the crucifixion, about to be ostracized, alienated, spit on. I mean, you know the storyline. It's powerful, and he sees it. He knows what's coming, sees it coming, and he's got this encounter with the disciples and mom from the Sons of Thunder is on the scene, the text tells us. And in the Amplified, it reads, I've just got two life lessons from 20 through 23 for my first life lesson. It reads this way. "Then the mother of Zebedee's children came to him," this is the Amplified, "with her sons, and kneeling, worshiped him and asked a favor of him. And he asked her, 'What do you wish? What wilt thou?' She answered him, 'Give orders that these two sons of mine may sit one at your right hand and one at your left in your kingdom.' But Jesus replied, 'You do not realize what you are asking.'" He's addressing that to the grouping. "Are you able to drink the cup that I am about to drink and to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they answered, "We are able." They answered, "We are able." He said to them, "You will drink my cup, but seats at my right hand and at my left are not mine to give, but they are for those to whom they have been ordained and prepared by my Father." Let me put the first life lesson up for our time together, if you don't mind, family. Believe and respond to God's personal preparation, his revealed purpose for your life, and his promised plan. Two keys to kingdom greatness: believe and respond to God's personal preparation, his revealed purpose for your life, and his promised plan. Where did you get that, Pastor? It's an interesting conversation to me as I read this, because just
a couple chapters earlier, in chapter 18, you might recall that the question that the disciples had come to Jesus and asked the question as he opens up that chapter 18, verse 1, who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And as you read that, it says, he called him a little child and put them in the midst of them and said, truly I say unto you, verse 3, that unless you repent, I didn't ask this to be put up, unless you change and turn around and become like little children, trusting, lowly, loving, forgiving, you can never enter into the kingdom of heaven at all. Whoever will humble himself, therefore, becomes trusting, lowly, loving, and forgiving, as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Now, that foundation has already been laid in the teaching. They've asked the question. Jesus has laid down the principles and the precepts. Am I talking to anybody yet? He's made it powerfully plain as he's demonstrated and modeled it in front of them what kingdom greatness looks like, how it acts, and what's the attitude that needs to be about it. But in the midst of that, he's as they ask the question, and now the mom, the mother of the children, James and John, the Zebedee's boys, the sons of Boanerges, the sons of Thunder, have now spoken on their behalf and asked the question, you know, can you put my boys at the right and left hand of yours in the kingdom when you get to your kingdom? He now goes into a deeper level of teaching with them. He now begins to peel back a little bit by asking the question. I love the way Jesus does this when he's dealing with us. When we bring to him either a question, or we bring to him, or particularly in the biblical narrative, and we bring to him an issue or a question and lay it out before them, he exposes not only our lack of understanding, but our level of preparation when he asks the question back. He says, but do you know what you're asking? Until you've brought to the Lord, and all of us have done this at some point, I contend, until you come to God with an issue that lays on your plate, a question that you have on your heart, and you put it before him in a time of prayer, meditation, prayerful meditation, and have the response come back to your spirit, but do you really know what you're asking? Sometimes the corrective, and until you've had that, you really haven't focused in and experienced how God prepares us, how God is shaping us, how God is moving in our life component and bringing us to where he needs us to be, because there's something powerful in the question that God asks, that it makes us reflect on the very thing that we're seeking with a different set of eyes. He says that, number one, that's not mine to give you. That's not what I have on the plate, that belongs to the Father. He has that determination. And after he asks the question, do you know what you're asking? Are you able to drink? And he takes him to the very core of the sacrament. Are you able to drink of this bitter cup, this cup of sorrow? Are you able to experience the baptism that is required in order for you to get to the end, even get to the endpoint that you're talking about, or make it through the journey you're going through? Would you be willing to lay down your life for the mission, for the cause that God has called you to? Well, God is preparing you for that. God is preparing you for that. And what I grabbed out of this is something, how God has, something personal and providential, how God has this powerful way of working in your life and my life, to prepare us for this moment in time that we live in even today. The struggles lay before us, the questions lay before us, the obstacles lay before us, the opportunities lay before us. And every now and then we find ourselves perhaps not fully understanding God's mission and purpose for our lives. And because we're missing the statement or missing the direction, fully not understanding it, perhaps we'll ask a question that really we've already got the answer for. Am I? You're quiet on me. Am I? Let me just talk a little bit then. Maybe we're asking the question, and God's graciously and lovingly blessing us and nurturing us through the answer, through the question-answer process that he's taking us through, to help us realize that we've had some of this conversation. I've given you the word. I've walked with you through the process of living. I brought you to this point in time. And now I need you to understand that there has been preparation poured into you by God, that has gotten you ready for the very challenges and opportunities that you have in front of you today. In other words, he says, if you just flip back a couple chapters, when you ask the question, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom, and I laid out the attitudinal principles that would govern the heart that governs that type of process or thinking or mindset or living that needs to take place, then you wouldn't come back with the same question, because if you're asking me the question again, then clearly you haven't absorbed the answer that I've given you fully. And because God is a merciful and gracious God, somebody other than me ought to be thankful to that. He walks with me through my stupidity. He helps me out when my flesh rises up and wants to ask a stupid question in the midst of this thing. And he says, you're my son and you're my daughter. And even though you're coming with me with stuff that I already told you the answer to, I'm going to love you enough to continue to walk with you through this process. I'm not going to smack you down or embarrass you or talk about you like a dog. I'm going to lovingly coach you through this process because you're my family. He says, and he walks them through this slowly. Are you able? He says, number one, do you know what you're asking? Secondly, are you able to drink of this cup? The cup of sorrow, be baptized, die to self, and be resurrected in newness of life. Let me expand on that a little bit. Are you able to that? And without question, the text tells me, without murmuring or stammering, the two of them stand up and say, we're able. If that's what it takes, let me paraphrase, if that's what it takes to get at the right hand and the left hand of you and the king, yeah, we're able, we'll do that, not even knowing what that could possibly look like. You see, this is what we do sometimes, friend. This is what we do. This is where we live sometimes. You look at something that you think is what you really want. You look beyond the process to the glory. And you say, Lord, can I have that? And the Lord said, but you got to, in order to get to that mountaintop experience, my son or daughter, there's a valley between where you are today and where the mountain is. Somebody's in the house talking to me today. There's a valley that looks like the shadow of death before you get to the mountaintop glory. Don't get all happy because you're up on the Mount of Transfiguration and think that you don't have to come back down to the valley of reality down here. There's a valley down here. And when you start talking about, yeah, I'm able, if that gets me to the mountain, yeah, I'm able, I'll be willing to do whatever you call me to do, you need to recognize that there's a cup. There's a cup. And there's a baptism. And then he gives them a little piece of a life lesson. That's number one, it's not mine to give. The Father hasn't delegated that responsibility to me. That's his. Secondly, he has a plan and a preparation and a purpose designed for those who would be at that position and those who will be at any position. How's he say? For those whom they have been ordained and prepared, the Amplified said, by the Father. So now that's good for you guys. But it also expands, if I can expand the application out to us, the preparation God is building into you is there to fulfill the purpose that God has for you in this kingdom journey. And in fulfilling the purpose, the preparation and the purpose, you know, those spiritual gifts that he's placed in you, that character that he's building in you, that opportunity that he's placing before you, that experience component that you walk through and you now are feeling some of the fruit of today, that knowledge, that experience or knowledge John loves to talk about of seeing how God's hand has been present in your journey, guiding and directing you and preserving you and protecting you and giving you peace in the midst of that. All of that is a part of God's preparation on how he gets you and prepares you for this moment in time and fulfilling the purpose that he has for you as it fills out the plan that he's got laid out in front of you. That's what I want to say. That's what I want to say. He said, yeah, Yeah, you're going to drink that. You're going to experience that. And it can only be done through the preparation and purpose and plan of God. And then the storyline goes on. But then the others heard this. Amplified catches this pretty good. They were indignant at the two brothers. That really is pretty good interpretation of the Greek. They were showing up mad, they were upset. They were ready to pounce on the two of them. The indignant is a pretty good term. They were indignant at the two brothers. And Jesus called them to him and said, illustration time, boys. You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great men hold them in subjection, tyrannizing over them. This is the Amplified version.
Great. That's it, Doc.
And he says, not so shall it be among you. But whosoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, must be your diakonos. From which we get the term deacon, servant. And whoever desires to be first among you must be your doulos.
Preach. Go ahead, Doc.
Bondslave. Who? And then he does this, and then he drops this interesting dynamite down on the table. He drops this illustrative dynamite on the table. Listen to it. Just as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, not to be waited on, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many, the price paid to set them free. Let me give you this second life lesson. Whew, he dropped that. He dropped that teaching right at the end of the question-answer dialogue that had just taken place, of the illustrative moment that had just taken place. And he said, you're able, just as the Son of Man. I got to get here. Two keys to kingdom, greatness, receive Christ's attitude of humility and selflessness. Receive it. You can't manufacture it. And respond to his call with committed and impassioned acts of service and ministry. This is so rich. This is so rich. He says, now look at the world around you, church. Look at the world around you. Here's a contrast. Here's a contrast. You want to see what worldly greatness looks like in the eyes of the unbelieving, secular, a humanistic component, put your label on it, philosophical thinking of the world system, the fallen world system. This is what it looks like. They call men great who have power and men and women who have power and dominate over others. Because the difficulty with getting great power without having the right spirit and the right heart in mind, without a transformed heart, is that it will always have a tendency to create domination and hurt the others. It is not designed to pour into others and seek the betterment of the object of its love. It's not an agape component here. It is purely power-based. You want to understand the difference between Christ-like servant leadership and worldly leadership? Look at who gets the glory in the midst of it. Look, who is it glorifying? And so the world's mentality said it's just a matter of time. You give the unbeliever, you give the flesh power, you get it when pride will well up and it will become dominant. It will absolutely seek its own interest and squash down everything in the midst of it. Tell me you cannot see that. He said that's the way the world acts. It dominates it. look at how they treat it. He could point them. Look at how the Romans are treating us. Look, and they're just an example of what's going on. Look at how, matter of fact, he could have said, look at how we treat each other. Y'all not talking to me yet. He said, let's get it in the religious realm. Look at how these religious folk the scribes, Pharisees, Sadducees want to look down their noses. They flash their phylactery. They wear their great robes, and they go prancing down the street like there's somebody big looking down at everybody else. Look at how they treat the poor. Look at how they treat the helpless and the homeless. Look at how they don't want no lepers coming near them. They don't want a blessing in the lives of anybody. They just want to quote scriptures and toss it out on the table to you like they're bigger and better than anybody else. That's the world's thinking. And you don't want to be fooled, you don't want to be ignorant, you don't want to be surprised at what will come at you from the world. But he said, it isn't about subjection and tyranny and domination that the world talks about. That's not kingdom principles. Not so. Not so. Let me amplify. Not so among you. But whoever wishes to be great must be a servant. The very opposite of what the world says. Because the world looks down on the servant and subjects it. It treats it with tyranny, treats it with subjection, treats it with, yeah. But God said, that's greatness. Because it can look beyond itself to the betterment of the object of its service. But Pastor, you don't know all the stuff I got going on. That sounds real good on the paper, and it's rolling off your lips real smooth up here behind the pulpit. But if you only knew the troubles I seen, then you wouldn't even ask that. How can Jesus have the audacity to make that statement to them? Well, here it is. Let me touch it anyway. Here it is. He makes a statement to them that he and the audience both recognize is impossible to the audience apart from him. Am I speaking truth? You can't be great in the kingdom and be a true servant like Christ is a servant, unless you have the personal relationship and thereby the empowerment of that comes with the relationship with Jesus Christ. You can't love your neighbor like you love yourself. You know that. You can try. You might even mimic it for a moment. But just as soon as your stuff starts crowding in, then you're going to kick neighbor to the curb. Come on, y'all not preaching to me. I know y'all need me to hurry on. Peter said, that's not the way we operate. And whosoever desires to be first among you must be the bondservant. Woo. Man, you don't know the kind of images that brings up to our heads when you start talking about that stuff. You know that we don't have the power. As much as we would love to muster up that kind of attitude and action, you know that it's not possible. And he said, that's what I know. My. So let me give you the example. Just as the Son of Man, eyes pointed toward the cross on his way to Jerusalem, knowing what he's about to face, about to stretch his arms out and pay the price for your sins and for mine, knowing he's going to be scourged, ridiculed, laughed at, spit on, knowing he's going to be whipped and with chain, knowing he's going to be dragged across the streets, going to have to drag his own cross, just as the Son of Man came not to be waited on, to be served, just like that. You want to know what it looks like? He says, just like that, but to give his life as a ransom for many. The price paid to set them free. He says, that's what it looks like in its purity. That's what it looks like. You want to know what it looks like? That's what it looks like, Jesus says. And it can't be done in your humanity without the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. You can't have the empowerment of the Holy Spirit unless you have the Holy Spirit living inside of you. You can't have the Holy Spirit living inside of you unless you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And when you do, the process of maturity in him, transformation, Christ-likeness begins to operate in you and maturing in you. And therein lies the potential for the practice. The attitude of humility and selflessness, the response of commitment and impassioned act of service. We do no more than the world does when we go visit the sick or visit those in jail or give clothing, open up compassion centers, give clothing, food to those who might be need a blessing, provide education and teaching, training, proclaiming the word, teaching the word, reaching out to those, touching those who we do no more than any humanitarian organization could possibly mimic if we don't bring Christ with our service. Can I preach that? We might as well just hang our sign up and call ourselves, the Humanitarian Society, if that's all we're going to do is toss our goodies and hand out fish. Because that's not transforming lives. That's not the message that will, that's not the message that's going to change them for eternity. And our responsibility, our core mission is not to be the Goodwill Society. Oh, y'all not gonna, I know I need to get off of here. Our mission, these are subsets to our mission. Our mission is about proclaiming the good news of the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Our mission is about modeling that impact that he has on our lives to others. We see drowning folk, and we need to toss them the raft, the life raft of Jesus. And it's not that we can save them, it's that we can point them toward the Savior. Maybe once in a while we've got to give them a fish and a piece of bread in order to get their attention. But once I have your attention, then I got to get to the core message. If I leave with you well-dressed, walking out of the Compassion Center looking sharp and fine, and you don't hear nothing about Jesus, I haven't done anything for the kingdom. I might feel a little better. You might feel a little better for a moment. But I'm not going to see you when we get to heaven. And being in heaven is a whole lot longer than being down here. Just in case nobody told you. And so Jesus says, here's the model. Here's the example. This is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to tell you what you need to do. I'm going to show you what is going to be done. And it requires the attitude only God can pour into you. And that's why he would say, Paul would grab hold of it and say, let this same attitude and purpose, this mind, be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Let him be the example of your humility. Amplified says, who although being essentially one with God and in the form of God, possessing the fullness of the attributes which make God God, did not think this equality with God to be a thing to be eagerly grasped or retained, I'm talking to somebody, but stripped himself of all the privileges and rightful dignity so as to assume the guise of a servant, a slave. In that he became like men and was born a human being, and after he had appeared in human form, I'm in chapter verse 8, he abased and humbled himself still further and carried his obedience to the extreme of death. Even the death on the cross. Therefore, because he stooped so low, God has highly exalted him. You want to talk about kingdom greatness? God has highly exalted him and has freely bestowed on him the name which is above every name. That in and at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue frankly and openly should confess and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Oh my goodness, come on, help me out here, church family. He stripped himself, the text says, Amplified, to assume the guise of a doulos, I believe is that term, of a bondservant. And then he, as Paul looks back on what has happened, thinking about what Jesus has told this group of men, he said, the greatest among you shall be your servant, diakonos, and whoever desires to be first among you must be a doulos. But you can't be that completely and effectively until you have given, accepted Christ and given your life to Christ and let him pour that heart attitude and power into you. And a thought that comes to my mind, and we're going home here, is that when I have a diakonos and a doulos mindset, and it accompanies my new creature, reality, a new creature in Christ Jesus, I will be able to look the enemy in the eye and speak blessing into his or her life. Because I realize that there's nothing that that enemy can say to me that's going to change who I am in Christ Jesus. Not one thing. Not one thing can the enemy do to me that's going to impact my relationship with God the Father through Christ Jesus. Not one thing can reshape the reality of my walk with Christ. He might fool me into thinking I can step away from some fellowship. But the reality is, once I'm a son, once you're a son or daughter of the King, you're a son or daughter of the King. And therefore, they can't pluck you out of God's hand. So that when I know who I am, when I've got a growing sense of God's purpose for my life, and I recognize that it's a part of his promised plan, then I can come, Brother Professor, to whatever opportunity and obstacle I face, and I can serve. I can serve with passion. I can serve with passion that is equipped with the power that comes from God Almighty. And know that my giving is not making me smaller. It's not belittling me. It's not about my, you see, the mama came to them with the boys with a statement of pride. Can you put my boys on both sides? It's going to be glory up there, and I heard about it. And I want to make sure my guys are taken care of. The boys had put her up to it, one text says. And mom was just loving her boys. And Jesus walked them through the tutorial and let them know that that process between here and the mountain has a valley. But there is a mountain. And in order to understand, let me illustrate what that looks like as I go to the cross. But when I go to the cross, it doesn't end on Friday. Because my text tells me that early Sunday morning, the victory was demonstrated and won as he got up. You see, there is going to be glory at the end of your valley experience. And so when we look for keys, when we look for the definition and keys to greatness, kingdom greatness, he points us at the sacrificial work of Jesus Christ. And then says, now I've empowered you to have the mind of Christ. Didn't the Bible tell us we have the mind of Christ? Believers? Let that mind be in you. The mind that he's placed in you, let that mind be in you. It's like a working out your own salvation. It's like understanding, this flashed in my head. It's like understanding Paul was saying in Ephesians that his salvation comes by grace and not through works. Because as mama and the boys would tell you that if it was through works, then I'd be prideful, and I'd be looking for thrones to sit on. I'd be looking for somebody to prop me up and make me feel big and good. I'd be looking for ways to dominate. Give me a seat. Give me a seat on both sides of you in your glory up there. That's the kind of works that we start boasting about. He said, that's why it's by grace, and you can't claim any merit by yourself. Can I talk to somebody? I'm going home. Let that mind be in you. Let that attitude define your actions, and then watch how God blesses. Have I been here long enough? Watch how God blesses. Father God, thank you for just giving us this moment. I'm so thankful for the day you blessed us with, for the family you brought to your house today, and for this short teachable moment you're taking us through, this powerful but short moment we've spent together. Prepare our hearts not only to receive and integrate your teaching into our life, but to be bold in sharing this good news. Help us to be diakonos and doulos. Help us to be ministers and bond slaves, Lord, for you, as we share this good news, knowing that you'll take care of the elevation process that needs to happen in our lives, Lord. You'll do what needs to be done, not our doing, but we're grateful. And Lord, in this world, corrupted and sinful and dark and damp, help us to be the light you've called us to be. We can only be what you prepare and position us and empower us to be. Help us to be the light and the salt. In Jesus' name we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Musicians are coming. We're going to open up the doors of the church, extend an invitation to you if you're here. So new members, directors will come down to receive you and invite you to come if you don't mind standing with us at this time. The doors are open. Invitation to membership is extended to you if you're here and you're seeking a church home family. We want to invite you to come down front and let us welcome you home. When your Christian experience was a candidate for baptism, all the way. Take that step of faith today and let us welcome you home. Turning back. No turning back. Going all the way. No turning back. Going all the way. No turning back. Going all the way. Going all the way. Going all the way. after they shared the Passover meal, I mean, after they, before they shared the Passover meal, that Thursday prior to the death and resurrection weekend, during that Passion Week, Jesus gathered in an upper room in Jerusalem with his closest disciples, and they're sharing the Passover meal. Scriptures share with us that he took the bread and he blessed it, broke it. This is my body, which is given for you. Likewise, he took the cup. Having blessed it, he said, this represents the blood of the new covenant, the blood which is shed for the new covenant, for the remission of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. First Sunday of each month, we come together as family, all believers. Please feel welcome to partake. And we reflect on God's goodness, his grace, and his mercy. That he would love you and me so much that he would become the Son of God, would become the Son of Man, tabernacle among us, live the sinless life, stretch out his arms on the cross voluntarily to pay the price for your sins and for mine, rise again early Sunday morning, that not only would our sins, the ransom, the payment for our sins be fulfilled, but the hope and assurance of life everlasting will be guaranteed. So we invite each and every one to share, and every believer to share in this time together with us. If you hold your elements till all are served, if you bow your heads for a moment, Father God, we just thank you that you love us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, that we who believe in him shall not perish, but have life everlasting. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to see this another Lord's Day. Come together into the house of prayer. Lift our voice in praise and worship. Spend time together in study of your word. That you would gird us up and prepare us and protect us as we go out into this world and share this good news, the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Now we ask your blessings upon the bread and the cup that we're about to receive, and bless us as we receive it. May it all be done to your glory, in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen. You hold your elements until all are served.
Sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing. From the water lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting in my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. Nothing else could help. God's love lifted me. Love, love, love lifted me. I know it's love lifted me. When nothing else could help. When nothing else could help. When nothing else could help. Love lifted me.
Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was given, broken for you and for me. Let us eat together. Representing the blood of our Lord and Savior, which was shed for the remission of your sins, let's drink together. Cover the cups, and we prepare our hearts to transition from the service of worship into the service of sharing the good news and living the life of Christ. Let's prepare our hearts as we close out with our closing song prior to our benediction. As we stand together, you know we gotta go home with some victory. Yeah, we gotta go home with some victory now. Thank you, Professor. Victory is mine. Lift your voice. Victory is mine. Claiming that victory, give him some praise in the house. Yeah, we don't live defeated lives in the kingdom, family. Victory is yours. Take your neighbor by the hand. Thank God for you today. Praying God's best, greatest, richest blessings upon your life. As we prepare to close with our benediction, thank our congregation that joined us via the internet TV this morning live. We thank God for you. We're praying for you. We're praying that God's moving in your heart even as we spend time closing out our time of worship together. Lifting up all the families who are traveling during this holiday season as you lift your hands to the Lord with our heads bowed, eyes closed, hearts humbled before the living God, assuming an attitude of prayer. Now unto him who is able to keep you and me from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. Now, henceforth, and forevermore, let all God's people say amen and amen. Sunday morning. Have a blessed week, family. Have a truly blessed week.